Full self-driving and why it could be worth well over $100,000. So I'm going to break this video up into three main categories. They're going to be value to you, value to others, and value to society. And in those three categories, I'm going to be breaking down some more points and explaining why full self-driving could very well be worth north of $100,000. So let's start off by talking about value to you. For value to you, it's like having a personal chauffeur. In the past, what you really had to do was A, buy a sort of expensive car and actually hire a chauffeur and actually have enough income to hire a chauffeur. So this is like having a personal chauffeur. The average chauffeur earns about $50,000 a year in the US. So essentially, in 2 years, this full self-driving upgrade that you'll buy will basically pay for itself. And this is just purely based off of chauffeur and just chauffeuring you around and driving you different places. Now, obviously, because it's an autonomous system, it doesn't actually require that much pay and you don't actually have to pay a person as it's not gonna go home or eat or feed a family or anything. So you can reduce the cost that way. Now, let's continue and talk about my second point, which is it can pick you up, drop you off, and if you're a two-car household, you can probably get rid of one car, provided the timings line up. For example, if a husband leaves for work at around 6 a.m. and the wife leaves at around 8 a.m., and then children have to go to school at around 9 a.m., just as an example. So the car would get ready by 5:30. 5:30 would take the husband to work. By 6 o'clock, he'll reach there. The car will come home by 6:30. Then it'll just be waiting, keeping the car warm and everything. Then the wife will go to work at around 8 o'clock, so she'll probably leave around 7:30. She'll arrive at around 8 o'clock, and then the car will be back home by 8:30. Now the car has a few minutes to just relax or whatever it needs to do, and while the children get ready, then it can take the children to school and drop them off. This is just another value to you as a family. And this could actually be quite useful depending on what type of household you are, how far your commute is, and various different factors that come into play with this. But it's just something that I haven't really seen talked about and just wanted to bring that point forward and present it to you. Now I'm going to talk about value to others. Now value to others, it can be in the form of, say, friends, family, relatives, or just a complete stranger. And this is value that you give to others, which means you own the car. And what you decide to do, for example, is if your friend needs a lift to go somewhere, you can just tell the car, be like, hey, go pick up my friend. And then your friend can decide wherever he wants to go. They can go to their place, destination, and maybe even pick them up if you so choose, because it's still your car. They can do that with your friends, with your family. Say your parents are living out of town. Maybe you want to pick up your parents and not want to bring a car for whatever reason, or just anything, you don't want them to drive, whatever the case may be. What you can do is tell the car to go there to their parents' house, pick your parents up. They can get in the car and drive you back to your house. And you can be assured that because it's a full self-driving system that you trust, that you use on a personal basis, everyday basis pretty much, that this system is very reliable and secure. And if it's not, then obviously you would not do this. Now, my third point for this is value to society. And basically, I got three main points that I've highlighted. So number one in value to society would be safer roads. Because this is going to be an autonomous software, it has to be drastically safer than a human driver before it even gets approved. To just get regulatory approval for such a system, an autonomous driving system, you need some really good data and some really hard proofs that this is so much better than a human, like literally so much better than a human. And this is just gonna be the case coming up in the future where these cars are just gonna be so much safer than a human driver. Now, the next point is that there's gonna be less traffic. And the reason why there's gonna be less traffic if all the cars, for example, become full self-driving is because you don't need all those cars sitting in parking lots all the time. And these cars can actually be traveling much, much, much quicker speeds. Most of the cars today, if you're on the highway, maybe go 70 miles an hour, maybe 80 miles an hour, depending on which state you're in. Now, these cars will be whipping around 100 plus miles an hour. So if you have an hour long commute, that can drop your hour long commute to less than 30 minutes if you're going fast enough, 120, 140 miles an hour, because these cars are built to handle those speeds. And electric cars, they cost very little to operate and they just have so much power to give, which just means that you got lots of room for expandability and those higher speeds. and these cars can handle it no problem. With those higher speeds and the fact that you'll have less cars on the road and less parking lots in general, you'll have less traffic. Because these are autonomous cars, they won't have the same problem that humans have. For example, if someone brakes ahead of you, you have to apply the brakes. They're less likely to make any of those human-prone errors, and most of the traffic is simply caused by human error. And an autonomous system just essentially takes the human entirely out of the picture. Now, my third point that I come to is that you have a lot more time for productivity or leisure or entertainment or whatever you want to do. You basically just have more time. For example, if your commute takes 1 hour each way, so 2 hour commute, you're spending about 8% of the day literally stuck in a car. Now, 30% of that is gone to sleep and just staying home and whatnot. Add another 8%, that we're just gonna round it off to about 40%. So 40%, almost half your day is gone simply because you have a long commute. Now, imagine during that commute, you can get some work done, like proper work done. So you don't have to stay at work for that long. And in this COVID world where we have online work from home and such, you basically don't even have to go to that place to actually work. It also leaves more opportunity. For example, if you have such a long commute, for whatever reason, you can go to sleep in the back of the car. So if you have a 3 hour long commute, you can just go to sleep, wake up when you're at your destination 3 hours later. And if that was just one way, imagine doing that both ways. That's basically your entire night's sleep right there, 6 hours of sleep. Another cool benefit for this would be entertainment. For example, a lot of people, after they're done work, they go home, they might watch some YouTube, Netflix, or whatever they want to do, watch some TV. And basically, you can do that when you're coming home or when you're going to work. So you just have a few more hours of the day for entertainment. Now, here's an experiment that you can do yourself. So take the price of the car that you bought it for, whether it's new, used, or whatever. Subtract that price from how much you'll actually sell the car for. And if you don't plan on selling the car and just keeping it until it breaks down, you could just write that as zero. So it would just be your price of the car. Now, divided by the number of years you're planning to keep the car, whether it's used or new. So if it's a new car, maybe you might keep it for 3-4 years. If it's a used one, you might keep it for 6-7 years. Just divide that cost that you got by however many years you intend to keep the car. Now, you basically have your yearly cost that the car is costing you every single year, whether or not you're gonna sell it. Basically, a depreciation cost. Now, add on top of that fuel, maintenance, and insurance, and calculate how much you're spending on that car just for transportation alone per year. Just do that. Now, you'll have a number in your mind that you've calculated. Now, if you have a gas or diesel car, divide that number, whatever it was, by 10. I'm gonna suppose the number was $10,000 for this example. So $10,000 a year is what you're spending, including fuel, maintenance, insurance, and including the depreciation of the car itself. Now, if we divide that number by 10, we get to $1,000. So with this Robotaxi network, what we're essentially saying is because these cars are gonna be electric and autonomous, they have to be both things. It won't work if it's only one. It has to be electric and autonomous. The reason why electric, because they last longer, they have much lower operating costs, and now we're almost getting to price parity between electric cars and gas engines. And really, in the near future, because EVs are still in their infancy, I see EVs becoming even more cheap than gas vehicles. Instead of spending $10,000 that you would normally spend on your car, you are only spending $1,000. And this does not mean that you are sacrificing on convenience. It will actually be more convenient because you would not have to park a car, maintain it, keep track of it, worry if it gets stolen, worry if there's any like scratches or just anything really. It's just not your car. It could be your car, and you can rent it out to other people and they can actually use this Robotaxi network, but you yourself, you don't have to do that. So say $1,000 per year. Now ask yourself this, if tomorrow you got a raise for about $9,000, because this example that I'm using here, if you're spending $10,000 and now say tomorrow you get this Robotaxi, you're using that and you're only spending $1,000, it's like you have $9,000 in the bank, which you can kind of act like getting an extra $9,000 raise per year. So just by that analogy alone, what we get is a car that is 10 times cheaper to run, operate, and use on a yearly basis than the car that you own right now. And the benefits don't just finish here. Here's another benefit. If you own that car, not only will it only cost you $1,000 a year to operate or just to go places for transportation, it will actually earn you money if you so choose. What you can do is set this car to act as like an Uber or Lyft, basically like a taxi. And that is what I'm talking about with this Robotaxi. It's an autonomous taxi network.
You say, what would be the probable gross profit from a single Robotaxi? We think probably something on the order of $30,000 per year. And we expect that we're designing the cars the same way that commercial semi-trucks are designed. Commercial semi-trucks are all designed for a million-mile life, and we're designing the cars for a million-mile life as well.
You can basically think of it as an Uber driver working 24/7. So with this Robotaxi network, what you basically get is a car that's driving people around, dropping them off at their destination, picking other people up, and essentially performing the duty of an Uber driver or a taxi, but at a much, much more reasonable cost, at a much lower rate, which means a lot more people are also likely to use it, especially because this is going to be cheaper than owning a vehicle. This is going to be a big advantage in the city where people have to park their cars, and it's much more of a hassle to park a car there than to just use a service such as like an Uber or Lyft or just even a regular taxi. The issue with those services are that they're quite expensive right now. And that is because they have to pay a driver, and the cars that they're running right now, they're petrol or diesel powered, which means they cost quite a bit to run and maintain. And with these autonomous electric taxis moving people around, first of all, you get the advantage of electric vehicles, which is less maintenance and cheaper to run. And because it's autonomous, it's like you have a driver in the car at all times, except you are managing it and it's transporting other people to their destination. And if this service can actually earn the owner of the vehicle about $30,000 a year, wouldn't everyone just want one? And moreover than that, rather than not everyone wanting one, why would companies sell you a car? And this is going to be my last point. Companies are going to stop selling you a car. Once they get rid of a steering wheel and pedals, they're not going to start selling you a car. They're only selling you cars right now because they don't have this network. So a company like Tesla is only going to sell you a car until they have full self-driving and they get rid of a steering wheel and the pedals. After that, they're going to bring everything in-house. They're going to produce their own cars. They're going to literally be making about $30,000 on each car, which means the manufacturing cost of that car is about $30,000. So within a year, they're already paid off their car or the manufacturing cost of the car. And really, the rest is just profit. And because these cars can last for 10 years, driving 100,000 miles a year, these cars can literally earn you 9 times as much money as selling the car would earn. And that is why I think full self-driving can be worth well over $100,000 purely because of this fact. Think about it. Today, the average Tesla costs about $50,000. So let's just take today's values and not include any advances that they have in manufacturing to bring the cost down for their vehicles. So say $50,000. Now, full self-driving cost $100,000. You add that together, that's $150,000. Now, with this Robotaxi network that's earning you about $30,000 a year, just as an example, and this isn't proven yet, so it still has to be proven, but let's take the example of $30,000 because that's the only number we have right now to base our calculations off of. $150,000 divided by $30,000, that's an ROI of 5 years, excluding any extra maintenance or insurance costs that you might have to pay or any extra cost added on top of that. So if in 5 years you have your money back, and then after that the car is still valid for another 5 years, and it basically doubles the value of the car, and it basically becomes the best investment of your life. And this is why Tesla and other companies, whoever actually makes full self-driving vehicles, are gonna stop selling cars in the future. They're just gonna manufacture them for themselves and literally put them out around the cities, around the globe, and literally let people use their network, because it'll be 10 times cheaper to use a Robotaxi than to buy and operate your own car. We're gonna see this shift first happening in the cities, then it's gonna move out to a suburban area, then more rural. It's gonna happen pretty quickly, and it's gonna happen within about 10 years. By 2030, most cities around the world, especially in the developed nations, will have autonomous vehicles taking people around. I even think that by 2035 or before 2035, it's gonna be illegal to drive a car in a city because it'll just be super unsafe. And our city is going to redesign, and it's going to have many advantages to society. And this is just one of the pictures that I wanted to put in your mind about a beautiful city, and we can have our cities back to normal rather than a congested traffic road filled city moving 2-ton hunks of metal around with one person inside and with no space to walk or bike or enjoy the city as a whole. So what do you think? What's our future gonna be like? Let me know in the comments down below, and thank you for watching. I'll talk to you next time.